Okay, yeah. Hi everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, I'm Tamo Krüger, and today I'm going to present fast cross-validation via sequential analysis. So this is joint work with my colleagues from the TU Berlin, Danny Pankne and Mikio Braun. So let's have a look. Cross-validation is something everyone here in the room has used before, but we all know that it's unfortunately also very time-consuming. So here's an example of our current project, so where we use fitted queue iteration in a reinforcement learning context. Even with a very small parameter grid, 10 times 10, we get half a million regression problems. And it would be cool to have some tool that boils these numbers down to a reasonable size. And as you also might imagine, directly optimizing the error landscape to avoid calculations is often difficult due to noise. So our new approach is that we use increasing subsets of the training data, and this has some nice properties. If we use smaller subsets, the training time is smaller. That's cool. More training data added to this model gets better error estimates, and what we will see in the next slide is that the relative behavior of the parameter configuration converges. So let's have a look whether this claim really is right. So what can we see here? This is on the x-axis, we see the sigma of a Gaussian kernel. On the y-axis, the classification error of some classifiers which have been learned on increasing training data sizes. So, and generally, the first thing that we observe is that we have some sigmas that are nearly never the best optimal parameter. And the other thing that we can see that these optimal parameters that attain have the best training error, this behavior of these sigmas converges. But what we also see is that with small training data size, some non-optimal parameter might be chosen, and so we have to take care that we not stop prematurely. So, and this is here an average over 500 repetitions, and what we can see here is 9 individual runs, and as you see, it's much more noisy, the error landscape, but the overall behavior that we have observed in this average case stays the same. So essentially, what we can see is our individual runs are noisy, but we can see the overall tendency of the parameters. We have a lot of underperforming parameter configurations, and we can estimate the correct parameters on a sufficiently large subset of the data. So how can we exploit this now? Our idea is to transform the pointwise errors of these configurations into a binary top or flop scheme with robust testing. On the way, drop significant loser configurations via tests from the sequential analysis framework, and furthermore, implement an early stopping procedure which decides whether we have reached these stable plateaus where we have seen enough data to really estimate the correct parameter, the optimal parameter. So how do we do this? Here's one step of our fast cross-validation procedure. We learn on a specific training data set size and can calculate the residuals on the remaining data set and gather these in this pointwise performance matrix. Then using the Friedman test, we can see and we order them according to the average mean square error. And with the Friedman test, we can test whether some configurations act significantly different than the top performing ones. And so we can categorize the configurations into top and flop configurations and copy this data to this trace matrix in a binary form. And then we can use these path behavior of all the configurations in these sequential analysis testing framework to identify significant loser configurations. So how is this done? Basically, this here's a graphical depiction of this test. Basically, it's a test which looks whether a binary random variable has a success probability of pi 1 or bigger of as pi 1 or smaller or equal to pi 0. And we can see here how this is done. We actually just denote here these cumulative sums of the traces. So a 0 means that we go one step to the right, and 1 means going one step diagonal upwards. And if a trace hits these regions, then we say it's either a loser or a winner region. After we have done this, we can categorize or label each of the remaining configurations as a significant loser or not. So in this case, the first two ones here are dropped. And to see whether we have reached this stable configuration, this stable region where we can really estimate the optimal parameter configuration, we use another test, the Cochrane-Q test. And we look with the given window size, with the sliding window here. In this case, it's a window size of 4, whether the remaining configurations act similar. So, and in this case, we can see that this first, this C3 configuration here, significantly differently behaves than the other remaining configurations. So we haven't reached this stable part that we have seen in this motivation slide. So the procedure says we have to go on. We need more data to really get to this stable parameter estimation point. So how do we choose these parameters for our sequential analysis test? We have seen that we cannot really use individual traces to determine whether a configuration is a top performer in the overall sense. So we have to look at the at all remaining configurations. So therefore, we fix this point here to the maximal number of steps. And since we want a really aggressive test, we say, okay, maximize this region here. And this gives us the pi 1 and pi 0 that we can readily plug into the sequential analysis framework and have a test which, given a specific significance level, beta and alpha, has these properties denoted here in this optimization problem. So, okay, what does this mean for our procedure? So we have to keep in mind that the fast cross, so the most difficult configurations for the fast cross validation are those configurations which are first flop configuration and then change to top configuration, to winner configurations. And therefore, we have to look how the test acts on these or behaves for these kind of configurations. And we have done a simulation study where we simulate these switching configurations, so to say, by binary random variables, which have a success probability ranging from 0.1 to 0.5. And at a given change point, changes this success probability to a straight 1. So going from a flop configuration to a top configuration. What we can see here are the ratios or the probability that these specific configurations would have been dropped. And the nice thing is that we have some kind of security zone where no configuration is dropped, so where we have no false positives, false negatives. So, and actually, we can also prove this. If the change point lies in this region here, then our algorithm has, so to say, a security zone where we have a false negative rate of 0. So this is pretty nice. So the experimenter can just fix these significance level alpha and beta, and we can calculate the pi 0 and pi 1 with this optimization problem that we have seen before, and he can estimate with this how conservative or aggressive the procedure is. So here's one example run of the fast cross-validation. What do we see here? On the x-axis, we see the steps of the fast cross-validation. On the y-axis, we see the configurations. Here we have roughly 600 configurations. A red bar means that the configuration is a flop at this step. A black bar means that it's a top configuration at this step. And gray means that these configurations have been flagged as a significant loser and are dropped. So, and what we can see here is that after two steps, nearly half of the configurations are dropped. So we get a nice speed increase here. And these blow-ups here, these small blow-ups, shows us the window of the early stopping rule. And we see the graphical depiction, so to say, of the behavior of this early stopping rule. So the procedure goes on until all remaining configurations turn out to be flops. So nearly all configurations which are kept here at this step 7 behaved similar in the past, and therefore the early stopping rule said, okay, we have reached some stable region and we can now estimate the correct optimal parameter. So does this really work? We have done some experiments on 8 classification and 7 regression data sets. For each data set, we use half for the parameter estimation, half for the test error estimation. We use the support vector machine or regression and kernel rich regression and kernel logistic regression with a Gaussian kernel of and 610 parameter configurations. And we estimate the optimal parameter once with a full tenfold cross validation and once with a fast cross validation procedure with 10 steps. Repeat this with different splits 50 times to get a statistic for this, and we compare the test error difference and the relative speed factor gain. So let's have a look first at the test error. So on the left side, we see the results for the classification data, and on the right for the regression data sets. For the regression, we have scaled the regressions so that these numbers are comparable. Generally, we see that the error difference, the absolute error difference between the fast cross-validation and the full cross-validation never exceeds 0.02. So this is quite nice, I think. And what do we get from this? So here we see the speed increase, the overall speed increase as before. On the left side, the classification data, right, the regression data. We see for classification, we get a speed up depending on the data set and on the method that is used of in ranges between 20 and 120 for one data set here. And for the regression, we get something around 40 and 100. So why is there this bias upwards in this regression case? You remember we are we have to categorize each configuration into either top or flop. And if we are in this regression case, we can calculate these top or flops on the residuals. So we have more information than in the classification case, where we just have whether we have categorized a data point correctly or not. And so this test here in this regression case can be much stricter and can drop or flag more configurations as flops. So. And therefore, we get a higher speed increase because we can drop more configurations on the way. So basically, that's it. Just to sum it up, so our motivation was to estimate the correct parameters on a sufficiently large subset of the data. We have transformed the cross-validation into arrays of configurations which get evaluated on linear increasing subsets of the data. And at each step of this race, we transform the test errors on individual data points of the remaining configurations into binary top or flop scheme with robust tests. On the way, we drop significant loser configurations with tests from the sequential analysis framework. And we apply distribution-free testing techniques to decide whether we have seen enough data to correctly estimate the optimal parameter. So basically, that's it from my side. So thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward for lively discussions.
Okay. So how would this method work with non-deterministic algorithms like neural networks?
Yeah.
Yeah. So would that be problematic for this method?
I think it's the same for a normal cross-validation. There you would have the same problems that you have in each run, this non-deterministic thing. And therefore, yeah, we don't lose anything, I think, because if you use a normal cross-validation, then you have the same problem. So, yeah. Yeah.
So, and that way you get all the nice conversion guarantees of bandit algorithms.
Mm-hmm.
It would be a rather straightforward way to put it on.
Yeah, sounds like an interesting idea. So, and I think we are doing it more in a, as you said, a sequential way, and we unroll it, so to say, and but using bandits, why not? Yeah, we should talk. So we haven't done any other experiments. We just use this linearly increasing thing. So, but perhaps it might be also a good idea to use other schemes. Yeah. Yeah.
But we know that the goodness of a configuration depends on the sample size.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
There's a flaw somewhere in this reasoning. If you could predict the shape of learning curves, which we would all love to know, then we could solve that.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
But maybe there's something. I mean, you might make a guess, like, you know, the amount of regularization is like one of the worst.
But yeah, I think you have to keep in mind that if you have a learning problem at hand, then you just have a limited amount of data. And for this, we just can use this amount of data to look at the shape, and the final shape will be the maximal number of data. So basically, this is what we want to exploit, to by linearly increasing subsets of the data, approximate this last curve, so to say, so the structure of the last curve.
Yeah, but you can see that from your smallest sample size, I'm looking at the filter here,
you
had one of the worst scores, the best configuration had one of the worst scores early on.
Yeah.
And the best configuration drifted as the sample size got larger.
Yeah.
You should be able to predict that to some extent.
So this is somehow a toy example that we specifically created to look at like this, because if we it has some smaller structure that you can just see at a specific training set size, and this is a behavior that we can see in this that we can actually see here. So if we have just 100 data points, then the cross validation fixes its optimal parameter to this global structure. And if we have more data at hand, then we see the fine-grained structure and can really estimate this optimal parameter reliably.
Why
Yeah.
Because we're giving the algorithm more data. So you're trying to predict the shape of the learning curve from a small, from a prefix of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, don't ruin all the questions. I guess people are reading.